Thanks, Brookie.
Australia is on track to become the second country in the world to roll out booster shots to the entire population. The TGA meeting today to make a decision, with authorities hopeful jabs could be in arms as early as next week.
Lieutenant General John Frewen heads the COVID vaccination task force, and he joins us now live from Canberra. Lieutenant General, thanks for your time again today. What's the story with the booster shots? When will they be rolling out, and will they be tied to vaccine passports?
Yeah, so look, we're just waiting on the finalised medical advice now. We expect that it will recommend probably between 6 to 12 months is when people should consider having a booster shot. We're ready now to commence rolling out booster shots when given the green light. Priority will go in the first instance to people in aged care facilities, disability facilities and frontline health workers. But I think what the process will be is that as your 6 months from your second shot ticks over, you'll be able to come in and grab a booster.
But will it be tied? Will you have to, you know, will that be linked to your passport whenever you show that wherever you go?
Yeah, look, that'll be policy decision, Carl, that I think is yet to be resolved. Mm. But for all intents and purposes, if you've had your first two doses, you are vaccinated, you are protected. Okay. But boosters just give you that little additional, pep up that just makes sure you've got the best possible protection.
Do you expect that we will need several vaccinations over the next few years, boosters rather, or is one booster enough to give us prolonged immunity?
Yeah, I think the medical science is still being resolved around that. Certainly this third shot booster is going to be recommended, but I don't think there's any clear guidance yet as to whether this will become an annual thing or not.
You have some issues in WA and also Queensland, not just in regional Queensland, but some areas even between the Gold Coast and Brisbane, that's in the Logan area. How are you going to fix that?
Yeah, so we're engaged with the authorities in both Queensland, WA and other areas of the country that are still lagging behind a little bit as well. And you probably know we're doing a lot of work with the Indigenous communities at the moment as well. With Queensland and WA, we're just saying that, look, New South Wales, Victoria are going to open up. That's going to see more movement. There'll be international travel. And that means Delta will be starting to get around more than it is at the moment, and it will find a way to the vulnerable. So vaccination is the best protection that you can have.
So this morning, Flight Centre boss Graham Screw-Turner has warned Queensland faces being shut off from the world for another 12 months if vaccination rates don't pick up there. What's your reaction to that?
Well, I mean, we're saying to people the best protection you can have is vaccine. And getting back to normal life really depends on getting these high rates of vaccination up. Australians have been amazing. We're up over 70% now, as you know, and we're at 86% first dose. But in those areas that it's lagging behind, there's still time before Christmas for people to go through that, you know, the minimum 6 week process to get the full protection, but they've really got to book in now to be ready.
Why do you think Queensland and WA are lagging so far behind? I mean, they seem to be throwing everything at getting the vaccine to people and making it accessible. So why are they lagging so far behind the rest of the country?
So in a lot of the areas where there's the numbers aren't quite as good as the national numbers, there has been some hesitancy. Sometimes the hesitancy is fueled by misinformation. But I think there is an issue of complacency in some of the places where there haven't been the types of outbreaks there have been in Sydney and Victoria. And we've seen when those outbreaks happen, that really causes an increase in demand for the vaccine. So we're just trying to get that message across without an outbreak and hopefully before any outbreak. So, you know, we've got enough vaccines now for everybody to get fully vaccinated. It's really easy and convenient to get vaccines if you want them now. There's full choice. It's all just about people making that decision. So I really just implore people who haven't yet to please come forward and get vaccinated.
Talking of messaging, we just featured a journalist who's leaked a story, an email from Tennis Australia saying unvaccinated players may be welcome in Victoria for the Australian Open next January. What sort of messaging do you think that sends?
Look, I'll keep coming back onto the message, Carl, that vaccines are the best way to protect you, your friends, your family. So really, I just encourage everyone to get vaccinated, not just for their own benefit, but for all of our benefits.
Very diplomatic, Lieutenant. Very.
So you've launched this new campaign, Lieutenant, called Spread Freedom. It's targeted those who are yet to get the jab. How important is it that people come forward now? What happens when the gates open in December?
Yeah, so Spread Freedom is, it's really aimed at that last 10 to 15% of us that haven't been vaccinated yet, and it just wants to make really plain the important link between vaccinations and the sort of freedoms we all want to enjoy in those states where we're about to get those freedoms back. Vaccination remains important, but in those states where they've had their freedoms for a long while without the outbreaks, you know, vaccination's really important to protect that as well. We've also got another campaign that we've just launched too, for all of us, which is specifically about Indigenous Australians as well, and some great Indigenous talent in there, Sam Harris, Baker Boy, others, really just sort of emphasising the message about the importance of vaccination to our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities as well.
You're so hip, Lieutenant General. Just rattling off some of the great young acts.
Lieutenant General, we appreciate your time this morning. Thank you.
Start of another big week in Australia's transition out of the pandemic as the country continues to power towards key vaccine targets. For more, we're joined by infectious disease specialist Dr. Nick Coatsworth in Canberra. Doctor, good morning to you. Lovely to see you on this Monday morning. Victoria will be almost entirely restriction-free next month. Cases, though, are still stubbornly high. Are you concerned about Victoria?
Cases are stubbornly high, Carl, but of course the hospitalisation rates have curved down, which we know is the powerful effect of vaccination. And as you say, Victorians coming out in their droves to get vaccinated, we are really surging as a nation now to beyond our expectations on our targets, and that can only be a good thing for our freedoms and our liberties to get come back.
There are concerns about regional parts of Victoria and New South Wales. There's a story in News Limited today about regional hospitals being likened to pubs with no beer, hospitals without doctors. Is that a worry for the regional parts of Australia right now, while those vaccinations are still stubbornly low?
Well, there is a gradient, Carl, as you would expect, the further you get away from the major cities. I've worked in some of the most regional hospitals in Australia. The important thing is that we have a very solid aeromedical retrieval network. Yeah. And, of course, the most important thing, though, is that the message to get vaccinated gets out to our regional areas, regional and remote areas, because that will be the most protection, more than any fancy hospital can give, is the vaccination. And so when we get those numbers up in regional areas, we can be a lot more comfortable.
Thousands of New South Wales kids return to classrooms today. Yoo-hoo, for a lot of parents in New South Wales. Are you concerned about transmission among young kids, though?
No, Carl, I'm not. We know that the major direction of transmission in schools is teacher to teacher and then teacher to student, and finally a distant third is student to student. So certainly less of a worry there. And as we've seen schools open around the world, we haven't really seen increases in transmission amongst adults, which has been put forward as a reason for concern. I don't believe it is. And I believe with the high adult vaccination rates we're seeing in Australia, which is going to approach world leading, then reopening our schools is going to be an exceptionally safe thing to do.
Australia is smashing vaccine goals. I mean, everyone needs to be incredibly proud of themselves. However, Queensland is still lagging. And they're right on the border, obviously, with New South Wales, where there are more cases. How do we get that vaccination rate up, and how much of a worry is it for when eventually this thing comes into Queensland?
Well, I think it is extraordinarily difficult, because you've seen that vaccination rates go up when the motivation is there, and the motivation is there when the cases are in your community. So I would simply say to Queenslanders, don't wait. I think Premier Palaszczuk's been doing a fantastic job of late in really encouraging Queenslanders to get themselves vaccinated. Don't be amongst those people who have waited and then find themselves in intensive care fighting for their lives. It's simply not worth it for the sake of a single vaccination, which is so easy and available.
OK, and just finally, booster shots could start rolling out within weeks. There is a concern immunity against the virus is running out the longer we wait, obviously, especially if you've gone more than 8 months since you had your second dose of one of the vaccines. So that's going to roll out, though. That is solid news. A lot of people need to be reminded of it, though.
Yep. Yeah, they do, Carl. Look, the good news is if you've had two injections of Pfizer or AstraZeneca, you're still protected at the same rate for severe hospitalisation and death. That is a 90% risk reduction. But we do know now that that extra booster is likely needed to give some more prolonged immunity. We're used to boosters in Australia. We have them every time for whooping cough and other illnesses, and this will be no exception.
What, 95% effective?
It still is. After two doses, your immunity is sustained against severe hospitalisation and death. It's just that you can be more likely to catch the disease. That's what's actually waning.
Interesting stuff. Good to talk to you, Doctor. Thank you.